there's also all of that internal motivation that we have. Like, and that's honestly what captivates me the most. So if someone could just subsidize me to sit in a windowless practice room for the rest of my life, that would be fantastic.
Hello, and welcome to the Musician Toolkit, episode number 67. I'm your host, David Lane, and it is great to be with you once again. If you are a first-time listener, welcome, and thank you so much for trying out this podcast. If this is not your first episode, welcome back, and thank you for continuing to check in. I'm going to go ahead and avoid the small talk that I might usually do for a minute or two at the beginning of an episode, because I have a fascinating conversation to share that is just a little longer than usual, or at least longer by recent episode standards, but it's a good one. Honestly, I'm surprised that I'm getting to episode 67, and this being only the second episode in the Instrument Spotlight series. The other episode in this series was way back on episode 18, all about the clarinet family with Kania Mills. That episode will be in the show notes if you'd like to check that out as well. The Instrument Spotlight series is meant to accomplish a few things for you, the listener. First of all, if you're trying to discover your primary instrument for the first time or a secondary instrument, I like having people who are both educators and accomplished performers on their instruments to come and chat about their instrument, the challenges, the repertoire, things that you need to know before buying an instrument, and things that you want to know as you're advancing on your instrument. So today's episode is all about spotlighting the French horn, and my guest is Kate Warren. As I mentioned several times in my conversation, Kate has a fascinating Instagram page. Her handle is at Kate Warren Music. If you play French horn on any level, or are even considering taking up the instrument, I think it goes without saying that she is a must-follow account. But as we really only barely hint in our conversation, and what I discovered about her account first, was that she has a whole lot of content that is not limited to the French horn, but a lot of things related to improving your practice. And some of those things harmonize with ways that I've discussed here previously, and some are ways that I haven't even really thought about, much less discussed. So that's a long way of saying that you should check out her account whether or not you play French horn, but absolutely if you play French horn or even thinking about it. One of the things I like about this conversation I'm about to share is that I received some education myself by just chatting with Kate. As you hear me bring this up, I'm not new to the French horn. I played it on a regular basis for 10 years, and Kate has some insight that challenges some of the things that I was taught, and frankly, she was taught when we were students. Now, I don't know about you, but I actually enjoy having conversations where it's not always, yes, I agree, but occasionally, there's some pushback and a challenge to think about things in a different way. On this episode, we're going to be talking about all things related to the French horn, as I mentioned already, but we're also going to be talking about different types of motivation and a tip on how to structure your practice. By the way, I need to offer my usual disclaimer up front for episodes like this one. This episode has several music sound bites. I'm fully confident that if you are listening to this episode on a podcast app, you will hear the episode as it was fully intended. But it's a bit of roulette as to whether or not that'll happen if you are listening to this on my YouTube feed. So if you hear any awkward silences for several seconds and you're on the YouTube feed, just know that that's what's missing, those musical excerpts, because YouTube has said, no, can't do that. And if you want to hear the full episode, you can check that out on a podcast app such as Apple Podcasts, Spotify, Amazon Music, or several others out there. Anyway, let's get to it. Here's my conversation with Kate Warren. It's my pleasure today to be talking to Kate Warren. Kate, thank you so much for joining me today.
Absolutely. Thank you so much for having me. I'm really excited to have this conversation about French horn things.
Well, it's exciting for me too, because as I mentioned a few times on this podcast before, I played French horn for quite a while. I started off as a pianist, and when I actually grew up right at the tail end of junior high becoming middle school, so it was seventh grade for me, not sixth, when I got to try a band instrument. Thought I was going to be doing trumpet because that's what my older brother did. But we had the same band director, and the band director just asked my mom, does he have an ear anything like his older brother? And my mom just blurted in, yes. And she's like, let's go try French horn instead. And the selling point for my mom was that the school provided a French horn for us to get started with. We would have had
that
to have
big.
Had our own trumpet, you know. So so that was one thing. And and I stuck with it through my undergrad years of college. You know, and then when I went to grad school, I didn't do anything with it. And over time, it kind of got relegated lower in my priority list, and so I don't have a French horn anymore. I said, but in what seemed like really poetic, I sold it for almost exactly the same amount that my parents had bought it for to a student who needed it, and the student was the same age I was when I got it in high school.
That's amazing.
So it just kind of felt like, okay, well, this is right, you know, for me to do this, you know. But every now and then I do think about getting a horn again, you know, just it'd be so great. But so this is the second in an instrumental spotlight series. So I like, you know, eventually I'd love for this podcast to be around 10 years and about once or twice a year, just kind of have an expert on an instrument talk about all about it. So whether or not you're listening as a beginner or you're in high school or in college and you're thinking you want to take that next step on the instrument, you kind of have some information of what you can do. So let's talk about yourself a little bit. So first of all, I love your Instagram channel. I'll talk about it a few times as we go. When I started this podcast, I knew some of the hashtags that I'd be using a lot. One of them was music practice, and I think I did a search on that and you came up, you know, right away. And I just loved your channel, not just because you played French horn, but because you offer so many great things on there, like as far as practice tips and some interesting concepts on structuring practice that I want to get to before we're done today. But how about a little bit about yourself as a musician? Did you always play French horn, or did you get there from another means?
Well, thank you for all those compliments about my Instagram channel. It's a labor of love, but it's really important to me for a lot of reasons. One of them being when I was young and trying to figure out how to get any good at my instrument, I was looking for resources online. And I found mine through a couple of blogs and a couple of podcasts. But for me, the part of why I have that channel is so that somebody else looking for those resources so they can get better can find them. Unlike you, I kind of stumbled into the French horn and into band against my will. My parents required that I be in band for a year. They are both artists, and they thought that being in band would make me well-rounded. And I did not want to do that. I wanted to be in PE with all of my friends. And they said, nope, you're doing band for 1 year. You can quit, but you have to do it for 1 year. So very begrudgingly, I was put into band class in the sixth grade, and I didn't want to be there, so I didn't really try very hard. But they were like, it's time to pick our instruments. I just like closed my eyes and I picked the one that sounded pretty, and somebody handed me a French horn. I was like, okay, this is my instrument. I can do it for 1 year, then I can quit band. And lo and behold, I actually really liked being in band, and all of my friends were in band, and I still wasn't any good at the French horn, but I ended up continuing on through band in middle school, and then, you know, in high school and college a second time and college a third time. And I don't think my parents saw that one coming, because when they found out how expensive a French horn was, they were like, oh no.
Yep.
But I was never any good at the French horn to start, and I actually still kind of say that, as I'm not very good at French horn. I just have no natural talent on it. In the seventh grade, so my second year in band, my band director brought me into her office and said, Kate, I know you want to be here, I think the French horn might be too hard for you. How would you feel about playing the trumpet? And she did. She asked me that. She asked me if I wanted to switch to an easier instrument. And that made me very, very mad and frustrated. So I practiced more, right? I hadn't been practicing because I didn't really want to be in band. But, you know, my band director just told me I was bad.
Right.
Like directly in a one-on-one conversation. It doesn't get much worse than that. So I started practicing. And by practicing, I got better at things. And that's kind of just how it worked forever until now. It's like, I don't have a lot of natural talent at the French horn, but I know very clearly that if I'm not any good at something and I practice it, it will get better. So then I've had this lifelong journey of okay, how are all the ways that I can make this practice easier, more effective, more efficient, blah, 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 because I have so much work to do. I have so many things I need to get better at.
Yeah. One of the things you just said right there was, I definitely relate to that. So in seventh grade, also for me, and that was my first year, you know, I was a pretty good pianist for my age. And it seems like I always felt pretty good about myself on piano recitals, you know, for the music I was playing for my age, and I did pretty well. And then in beginning band, it was a pretty large middle school, again, junior high at the time, but, we had seven French horns and, you know, just, you know, for those who don't know, there is a chair system, you know, that a lot of most bands and orchestras use. If you are first chair, you are doing the best. If you have seven French horns in your seventh chair, you're doing the worst. I was seventh chair. And that was after, like, we auditioned four chairs. It's like we weren't placed there randomly. We all had to do an exercise. And like the big one was what's called a lip trill. It was like without pressing the vowels, you had to play what would be a written middle C, E, G, B flat C. And I couldn't do that. It's like, I couldn't do it to have it sound any very good. But when I was last chair, I found out
Can I catch you real quick?
Oh, sure.
Just for the French horn players listening who are learning, we would call that a lip slur, a lip trill.
Oh, sorry.
You said lip trill, and I was like, oh my gosh, they asked you to play lip trill in the seventh grade.
Oh, gosh. So I probably mixed up the terms in my head, but thank you. Yes, a lip slur. So I found out when the next audition was going to be, and I too got really mad, and I auditioned. You know, I made sure that I was ready the next time. And then I made second chair. And, you know, I was in seventh grade. First chair was a ninth grader. So I was like, oh, I'm okay with that.
Okay.
Like, she's got a two-year head start on me. I'm okay with that. But it is funny. So, sometimes musicians, when they're presented with either thing with us, it's curious how they react. Because some students will react with... kind of a defeatism, you know. There are people that would not have reacted the way you did if said, would you like to switch to trumpet? They'd be like, oh God, yes. Let me go to trumpet. You know, anything to avoid a challenge, you know. I think one of the tools of becoming a great musician at some point, and I know that you said you don't have any natural talent at it, but you've worked very hard and you've accomplished, you know, quite a bit. And I think it's that drive to kind of prove people wrong, you know, and you know, some people argue whether or not that's a good motivation, but I think it is a motivation that it's a response that I think does help push you forward.
I think there's absolutely a time and a place for that, for internal and external motivation, right? Mm-hmm. External motivation is like, oh, somebody doubts me, something, I need to win a competition. I need to, these things that validate us on the outside. But there's also all of that internal motivation that we have. Like, and that's honestly what captivates me the most. So if someone could just subsidize me to sit in a windowless practice room for the rest of my life, that would be fantastic. But that internal drive of like, oh no, I can do better than that. I can be a little clearer on that, or a little rounder and XYZ thing. Right, there's a time and a place for both, because there are ways that we can use external motivation in really healthy manners to help us grow. But that's also like a really slippery slope where all of a sudden it's like, oh, I'm not getting this external validation. And that can become a little like personally degrading. And we always want to make sure that anytime we're using external motivation, we're doing so in a healthy manner that's not related to our self-worth or our like anything other than, did I achieve this X or Y?
Nice. So I'm assuming, you know, obviously, you know, you practiced, you got better at horn, you stuck with it, obviously got through high school. I gather, you know, I actually have seen some of your posts that you've done the marching band experience as well. So we'll allude to that a little bit, talking about some similar instruments. Spoiler, you don't typically march with the same French horn you play in a concert. Although I've seen that before. I've seen some people do that, but it's...
Yeah. It happens. Yeah. I'm glad it's never happened to me.
Right. But what... After high school, did you do a performance track in college, or did you do something else?
So I have 3 degrees in French horn performance.
Okay.
I went and did my bachelor's at Florida State and got a performance degree. For undergrad, that's a little unusual. A lot of people will get an education degree. And in hindsight, if I could go back, I would absolutely get an education degree. I think that would be way more applicable to what I ended up doing now. But after Florida State, I went and got a master's in French horn performance at the New School. And then after that, at the end of COVID, I went to Yale to get a second master's. It's a little different. It's called a master's of the musical arts, also in French horn performance. So I have all 3 of my degrees in this very myopically focused path of how to play French horn, period. Nothing else. No right. Tangents.
Nice. So, yeah, you've spent a lot of time on the French horn, and, you know, I think it's a worthwhile instrument to spend time on. Let's talk a little bit about the French horn as an instrument. So, one of my previous episodes was all about the overtone series, and I happened to use just a section of that to explain why I think it is when people say that the French horn is the most difficult of the brass instruments. So, not going to make everybody go listen to that, and just to hear a different perspective, tell us kind of what you understand about the overtone series and how that affects the French horn.
Of course. I put up a post on my Instagram channel, Kate Warren Music, a while ago about this, like specifically why the overtone series makes the French horn more difficult to play. And people came for me in really mean and aggressive ways, but you're correct that it's a fact that French horn is more difficult to play because of where in the overtone series its most commonly used register is. If you go back and listen to this episode about overtones, hopefully you'll hear about all of the different intervals that happen in the overtone series. And as we get higher, those intervals compress. They get smaller, and eventually they become just half steps, and they're nearly indistinguishable from each other. The kicker is that most brass instruments, not the French horn, play in the bottom of that range, where the overtones are the farthest apart. So some of them are a fifth apart, a third apart, an octave apart. Versus the French horn, which plays in the middle top of that most often, where all of these notes are like a whole step or a half step apart. So when we're thinking about why this makes the French horn difficult, it's as if playing like trumpet and tuba, if you were throwing darts, you've just got like big plastic buckets. You have 3 big plastic buckets. Like, oh, these are huge targets, pretty easy to get it into these most of the time. Except on French horn, they're like water glasses, and you have 10 of them. Yeah. And maybe some of them are like behind other water glasses. Like, yeah, you can still get good at that. But from the baseline of skill, it takes some effort to gain that precision. And that's what makes, and I think the important distinction here is, I don't think French horn is necessarily a more difficult instrument to play, but it's absolutely a more difficult instrument to learn, particularly for beginners. And I know one of the things you wanted to talk about was the single horn versus the double horn. Yes. And a big argument that comes into play for like early childhood music education on starting young students on single French horns is just because there are far fewer targets to hit. Because when you give someone a double French horn, you give them double the targets, which makes it twice as hard. And you know, when you don't know how to do something, you're gonna be bad at it at the beginning, and that's okay. That's part of the learning process. But by using those single instruments, it helps a little bit.
Yeah. Let's take that. So talking about, like, you know, there's a single horn and the double horn. I think probably the biggest argument for starting with a single horn is that it's not as expensive, right? Because it's like Well, you know, it's half the horn. Double horn is, you know, and we kind of skipped over one thing. So French horn is often labeled in music as a horn in F, but we'll talk about transpositions in just a moment. But for now, just kind of say, yeah, the horn is an F instrument. But if you have a double horn, you have a thumb valve. But you also have a whole lot more tubing kind of going on underneath, you know, just kind of connects it to it. And it makes it a B, you know, makes a B flat horn, if I remember it correctly, sort of like that. It's like at one point I figured out at one point I figured out it was like it made it the fingerings you'd use on a trumpet, you know, on like some of the lower notes.
Pretty close. It's like almost the fingerings on a trumpet.
Yes.
So your double French horn, we read in F, and that's why they say horn in F, because the pitches on the page we're reading in F compared to like a piano, which reads in C, or a trumpet, which reads in B flat. But the reality for a double horn is you have, it's almost like two French horns glued together. You've got the F side, the F French horn, and then you're right, with the thumb, you activate the B flat side. So a whole second set of tubing that is in a different key. It's obviously pitched up into B flat, which helps us a little bit with these partials as they get closer together, right? We've moved our overtone series up. So now it's like things are farther away. And that's why we tend to use the B flat side in the high range and the F in the low range, generally speaking.
Right.
And then when we have single horns, you actually can have both. There are single horns in F and there are single horns in B flat. It's a little more common to find them in F, but there are people who start students on single B flat horns, and I think it has all of the same merits as starting someone on a single F horn.
Nice. Now, I've heard this argument before, and you just tell me if you've heard differently or similarly, and that is to try to always use the F. So if you're playing an F horn, try to use the F horn side around like the G above middle C and lower, and once you get above that, use the double horn. And what I was told was that the double horn side doesn't have the as good of a tone as the F side. It's like, so if you're playing the F horn, you have the more potential for a better tone, but the B flat gives you slightly less tone. But at the same time, you now have the overtones further apart and can handle those higher notes a little better. Is that similar to what you've heard?
I'm sorry somebody told you that.
Oh, okay. Not correct me then.
if we're painting really broad strokes, mm-hmm. I wouldn't say one is good and one is bad. They are different.
Okay.
The F horn is bigger instrument, physically speaking. Like if you unraveled that tubing, it is longer. Mm. Which makes it a darker and a rounder sound, just because it's a little bit warmer, it's a little bit deeper. In contrast, the B flat horn then is a little brighter.
Right.
But neither of them are good or bad. They're just different.
Right.
and on some French horns, they're really different. And it's like, whoa, yeah, okay, maybe I am making fingering decisions based off of the color that I want to be using here. But when you get to some of the more quality instruments, and that's like even like there are quality beginner instruments, there are not quality beginner instruments. There are quality advanced instruments, and there are not quality advanced instruments. So that's really dependent on the French horn that you have, because there are plenty of French horns where the F and the B flat side are a little different, but not in a way that's going to really influence you regularly. Maybe I'll pick one fingering here or there because I want some extra shimmer, I want a little brightness, or I want something to be really moody. But for the most part, these are interchangeable, and we end up using the B flat and the F side more to help us with fingering patterns, to help us with pitch accuracy, and less so because one is good and one is bad.
Well, I appreciate that that correction, because you know, I've made a point as a teacher, you know, in piano, and I also teach composition and music theory, and try to talk about, like, we talk about a minor second. Like, I do correct students when they say that sounds bad. It's like, no, let's think about it a different way. It doesn't sound bad.
We're just not used to it.
Sounds tense. You know, it's like we can describe it in other ways. So yeah, it's kind of funny though. The first, I'm that was kind of a parrot of something that I was told And I'm pretty sure I was told it at Florida State when I went there for solo and ensemble in 11th grade. And that was when I was told to get a double horn by, now I don't know if the judge was a teacher there, you know, it may not have been, but, and I'm not even sure who the teacher, I'd have to dig out like all my papers if I was, but yeah, that was like the big thing. It was state solo and ensemble. And that was, I got a superior, but it was kind of like a caveat. It goes, don't come back here with a single horn next year. It was kind of pretty much what he said. And I think that was to nudge my parents to, you know, let them know it was serious and we had to go buy a double horn. But yeah, I think there is a thought, and this is something I hadn't planned on talking about. There's a stereotype that the French horn is the mellow, pretty, you know, warm sounding brass instrument. But fact is, if you listen to a whole lot of music, you've got a quite variety of tones. Like, you know, I'm just thinking it's that moment in Mahler's first symphony, the second movement, where the bells are up and your hand is stopped. And, you know, and it's really an angry sound. It's like, but you've got some, you can have really aggressive, really bright, edgy sounds. You know, there's a lot of things that you can do with the horn. So some of that, I wonder, is it all technique or does the mouthpiece have anything to do with that?
One of my favorite things about the French horn and what I think makes it the most fun and interesting brass instrument to play is that its range is nearly double all the other brass instruments. So like a trumpet has a regular usable range of about 2 octaves. Same for trombone, same for tuba. French horn has 4. Mm-hmm. And part of that versatility of having this 4-octave range that most horn players are expected to use, right? This is not like the screamer trumpet who gets the extra octave in the top. Like, no, this is just what our parts get written for, is that we now have twice as many color options, twice as many tessitura options. And that makes it so that we can play in these beautiful, warm, rich, mellow sounds and these regal characters that a lot of music tends to put us in. But we can also be shrill and bright and deep and fat. And we have this range and versatility to play all types of styles, colors, and feelings.
Nice. And I also kind of allude, there's a thing that a French horn can do that is really neat. So all brass instruments have mutes. You can put a mute in there and the mutes are different, you know, they act different ways. But one thing a French horn player can do, they can just stick their hand directly in the bell and we'd call that stopped. And,
yep.
And nice thing about it is I don't think it's quite across the board, but for a lot of the notes, if you stop it, it goes about a half step flat. So I wrote a piece that I really liked. I think I was actually inspired by a Jerry Goldsmith score. It's a movie called The Shadow, and kind of under the radar film with Alec Baldwin from like 1994 or somewhere around then. But right after the main title, he has this scene, and Jerry Goldsmith wrote, it's three French horns. They're playing a minor triad, and they all stop their horn at the same time and then pull it out. So it sounds like it slides down a half step, the whole chord, like C minor to B minor and back to C minor. And that was the cool thing. So I made that major and I did what's called a scherzo for three horns. And it was for my senior composition recital. And, one of the horn players had the detachable bell and he was always in whether it was band or orchestra, he was always, just to see if anyone would notice, wearing it as a hat. And, you know, and it annoyed most people, but I said, when we come out to play this piece, I want you to come out with the bell on your head and we're all going to go to the wrong stands, realize we're at the wrong stands, make a switch. Then we'll look at you at that bell on your head, and then you'll realize it, put it back on its horn. And, you know, it's a funny sound, but it's an entertaining thing. And not a lot of composers have done that effect. I think like Benjamin Britten might have done something like that, but it's a cool little effect. You know, if you're ever playing a French horn, just hold on to a tone and put that hand right in. It's a really cool. Gosh, so this is such a complex instrument. It's hard to know where to begin. We talked about overtones. We talked about the difficulties. We talked about the double horn. When do you think, you know, I know you're a teacher, when do you think is the right time to get a double horn?
I think that's very dependent on the student and the program that they're in. I'll give you two answers.
Okay.
I think typically, like with the students in my studio, it tends to be around the 1 year mark. About a year after they've been playing the French horn, I feel like they tend to be ready to make that switch to double horn. When we're talking specifically about like what skills should they have before they should switch to the double horn, for me and my students, I usually say like once we've gotten to F at the top of the staff, and they're pretty comfortable with all of the notes into that range, right? Because when we start getting to the top of the staff, that's when the things on the single F horn get difficult. Mm-hmm. So once we've introduced F on the top of the staff and they have basic comprehension of maybe like the F major scale's range, one octave, then I tend to put them on a double horn and say, great, you just learned that. We're going to change all these fingerings. Please forget the old ones. And so I had a student who switched to double horn this year, and we did, that was right around when she switched. And all of a sudden, 2 weeks later, she's like, I have a low F below the staff. And I was just like, you practiced this week, didn't you? And it becomes this fun, like they have enough facility that they can actually explore the new instrument and figure out all the ways it makes their life more easy and interesting.
Yeah, nice. I was also just thinking about, talked about that low note on the horn. So I was, when I was in my best shape, a prototypical third horn player. And in other words, I could play all the high notes, couldn't play any of the low notes. And I really struggled with this. I took brass methods in college. So I also went in Florida. I went to Jacksonville, JU. And we had a brass methods course there. And first time I played the tuba, it was hilarious. Because I was playing notes that you would write in treble clef for the tuba. And I could hardly get within like an octave and a half of the lowest note. I felt like my jaw was about to drop into my chest. And I just could not do it. And I think it's just, I have a tendency to have trouble relaxing. And I don't know if that's it. So I'll ask you, just for me, is there like a single tip that you can get if I ever get hold of a French horn again to help with low range?
I think there's a big difference between low range on French horn and the low brass instruments.
Right.
Part of why it's so difficult to, I'm a doubler, a very often doubler. And what makes it difficult to switch from the high brass to the low brass is that we go from using these very minute, small, tiny muscles in the middle of our mouth to all of a sudden your vibrating aperture is your whole lips. And if you're used to only using the very itty bitty middle of it, that's a really different feeling. And it involves such different musculature to get that low brass buzz than to get the high brass buzz. And that is why you very infrequently see the doubler who plays all four, right? You see the high brass doubler and the low brass doubler, but you tend not to see the cross genre. For French horn, I was working with a student yesterday on the below the staff register. And I think a lot of that has to do with the consistency of your airflow, because those partials are so wide, because there's so much room to maneuver. We have to have a consistent input into the instrument. And also the musculature structure on the outside. So right, we're talking about, we have this internal aperture, the flesh on our lips, but I'm talking about like the structure built by the sides of your cheeks, the corners, the height, the width of the jaw, all of that infrastructure that lets your resonator do its job at a little bit wider of a setting than it's used to doing.
Yes. Yeah. And it's funny, I had a teacher for one semester. It was one of those things where I had a French horn teacher, but it was technically my third instrument because it was a composition major. Piano was my principal instrument and I had to take lessons in both. So horn was third. And after like one semester, I think it was one semester, I found out that I wasn't actually required to take lessons, and you know, I kind of, it disappoints me that I was like this when I was in college, but I was like, oh, I don't have to do it. I'm not doing
it. Okay, but music school
is
so busy. An undergraduate music degree is the busiest time any musician's ever going to have in their life. And we can look back at it and go, shucks, I wish I did XYZ. But I mean, I assume your music education was similar to mine. I vividly remember a semester where I took 12 courses for 13 credits. Mm.
Yeah.
And it's like, that's unsustainable.
So
don't give yourself any kind of regret over that.
I don't know how many courses, but I know I had like some 16, 17 credit semesters. So yeah. But the irony, there's the teacher that I had, if I had stuck with him, I might've gotten better, because he told me, and he's held fourth chair in the Jacksonville Symphony for many years. I don't know if he's still there, but at the time he had held it for many years. And he mentioned, you know, that was by design. He goes, a lot of people are so excited about the high range, they don't practice the low range on the horn. He did. He spent extra time on it. And he said he felt very confident that he could play that, as you know, on the bottom end of the horn about as well as anybody else auditioning. So he goes, he didn't have any, you know, goals to be first horn. He was happy to go to be in a professional orchestra being paid on fourth horn. I just thought that was very interesting. I thought maybe I could do that with third horn. But, you know, my ambitions just never allowed me to, you know, really take that next step. The other thing I could never do on horn was I could never flutter tongue, but I also can't roll my R's. So probably I feel like if I fixed one, I could probably fix the other.
Probably.
Yeah. When it comes to mouthpieces, does it matter? Because, you know, if anyone's listening to this and they're thinking, you know, my middle schooler is going to try French horn and the school is going to provide it, but you still have to go get your own mouthpiece. So is there a certain type of mouthpiece or two that you recommend when getting started?
I have two pieces of advice here.
Okay.
The first being, do not use that mouthpiece that comes in the French horn case. Even the best instruments in the world, even like the most thoughtfully and expensively designed French horns, the mouthpiece that comes in the case is not what they're putting their R&D into. It is bad. Throw it away.
Right.
Get rid of it. I don't know. Use it as a cup holder for a flower or something. Don't use that mouthpiece. And the second being, you don't, like, especially for beginners, you don't need to think that hard about the mouthpiece that you are playing on.
Right.
Find something that is in the middle of the road. You don't need something crazy big or something crazy small. You don't need something any realm of extreme you don't need. And this is true for like most players, even advanced players. Find something in the middle of the road. Find something that fits very generally speaking in normal. Maybe this is your Holton Farkas MDC. Maybe this is your Lasky 75G. And if you look up like normal French horn mouthpieces on any kind of French horn forum or like the Horn Matters blog, by John Erickson, Dr. John Erickson in Arizona State University. Great resource. There's lots of stuff on like equipment for beginners and for young players. Yeah, but anything in the middle of the road, anything normal and standard.
Yes. And you know, a question I thought about asking but decided not to is about like just embouchure. And I remembered, it's been a long time since I read it, but there's like The Art of the French Horn, and it's like by, was it Farkas, I think is the author's name.
Philip Farkas, Art of French Horn Playing.
Yes. And, you know, in like one of the first two chapters, there's a bunch of photos of actual professional horn embouchures, and they look kind of similar, but they're all a little bit different. I just feel like that's something, you know, should it be two-thirds top, one-third bottom, should be half and half. I feel like each teacher is going to kind of nudge slightly different ratio with that. So, but you know, embouchure, if you hear us talking about it and you're like, what is that? That's just like the mouth placement and the muscles, you know, go into the mouthpiece. But which is, I think for most, whatever brass instrument you choose, I feel like that's where the work has to go. It's like, for me, it wasn't learning fingerings. I learned all my fingerings in a month, you know, but it's constant work in progress to try to get that embouchure just right so that you can control the sound. Does that sound about right?
Yes. I want to take two steps back.
Okay.
To talk about The Art of French Horn Playing, because when you grew up and when I grew up, there was this, everyone was like, oh, this is the French horn Bible. Mm-hmm. It's The Art of French Horn Playing by Philip Farkas. It's a blue cover with a big purple H on it. Like, right. Any French horn player owns it. Mine is like right over there.
Right.
And it was a really great resource when it came out. Mm-hmm. And now is very outdated and bad information.
Okay.
So like, you brought it up and I want to make sure that the young horn players who are listening to this, it is super cool. And there's so much awesome information in there and you should totally read it. But he has a very black and white, just like you were talking about, a very black and white opinion on what is right and wrong with how to play a French horn. Mm-hmm. In his text, there is one way to do it and it's his way. And there are no variations on that. And that is not true. So if you read this book, read it with a grain of salt. Take everything he says and think about it. But if it does not fit the mold of you and your playing, it's totally okay to just go, okay, that worked for him. Because everybody's mouth and everybody's teeth and everybody's tongue and everybody's French horn and everybody's mouthpiece are different.
Yes.
And what works for me, what works for you, might be helpful, but it might not be. And it might not be what works for you either. And that's okay. And if you do have a teacher that tells you like, oh, this is the one and only way to play the French horn, run away.
I think that's the history of music pedagogy, by the way, because, you know, like pianists is like, there's a singular way you're supposed to play the piano. And now if you look around, you can find different ways. It was actually funny when I was in undergraduate school, my piano teacher that I used was right next door to the other full-time piano teacher. And they would sometimes have arguments when, you know, they didn't think students were really watching about what the wrist does. You know, like one says the wrist should always be moved freely and goes, no, the wrist should stay still. So, and these are two really excellent players. So yeah, there's always going to be some variance in teacher philosophy, but also hopefully the teacher's taking the student into account, you know? So yes, that's not just French horn. If you have any instrument,
yes,
and the teacher says, this is the only way. Yes. You should definitely, definitely find somebody else or try somebody else. I know you have, I was looking at recent posts before I logged on here and I was going to ask about like recommended etudes. And I saw, was it Bernard Edward Mueller?
Mueller.
But I was thinking beginning and intermediate, is that more advanced or where do you recommend those etudes?
I love the Mueller studies. They are not for beginners.
Right. So where do we...
I am 3 years into trying to record all 22 of them, if that tells you about their skill level.
Okay, so not for beginners, but definitely something to aspire to. What are some good resources, though, you know, like outside of someone's band or orchestra practice, of just some etudes for French horn when you're in your first or second year or so?
That's a little tricky, and it falls into the same bucket about what we were just talking about like the old school pedagogy for teaching music,
right,
being black and white and very prescribed and exact. And there used to be this idea that the only way you could get better at your instrument was just to learn a bunch of etudes. Mm-hmm. And that is one way to get better at your instrument. And if etudes are fun and mm-hmm. interesting and fulfilling for you, there are lots of ones that I would suggest, like the Koprosch books. They're boring to me. I don't actually don't like them, but a lot of people like them.
Yeah.
The Gallet books. There are some Patag books. There's a Patag Hovey method for French horn. So kind of fits in the same vein of your essential elements, standards of excellence, like starts easy, gets hard, mm-hmm. not like the fingering for F is first valve, kind of easy. But he or they, both of them, write it around a lot of American folk tunes. So I find that one really interesting because if you listen to any kind of, if you're a churchgoer, you listen to congregational music, if you are big into like breadbasket Americana, there are lots of like public songs and work songs and things like that that you might find familiar. Etude books are not necessarily my area of expertise, but I'm positive that there are some that are not written by 1940s white men that you could look into that would probably have maybe hipper, newer music that you see on the TV or on the whatever that you watch. And maybe you find that more interesting than right. playing a bunch of scale-based Koprosch etudes. There are also tons of solo works written for beginner skill levels. And in that case, I would say find a French horn teacher in your area and say, hey, do you have some suggestions for grade one or grade two repertoire that I could look at? If you have solo and ensemble where you live, even if you're not a high school student, right? You don't need to be a high school student to look on the website for solo and ensemble and find their graded list of repertoire and go look at what they have available for grade one. So the lower numbers are the easier stuff, one, two, three. Higher numbers, I think most places tend to go up to five, six, or seven, depending on what state you're in. But those can be great resources to find repertoire that might be within your skill level, whatever your skill level can be.
Nice. So what are some pieces that, you know, we could just talk about ones that just for you that you find are ones that you enjoy and they're ones to shoot for. And I kind of suggested some categories. So like French horn, maybe like a sonata or a solo and piano, maybe like a concerto, solo and orchestra. Let's limit it to those two. So like, what are a couple of pieces that you are, or some examples of some pieces you really love?
So I'm a little atypical in that my favorite genre music is contemporary atonal neoclassical music. So, nice. So I, like, the first thing that comes to mind is I can't remember the last time I played a sonata.
Right.
I played a really interesting duet for horn, clarinet, and computer last year by Christopher Biggs called Incommensurable, which was incommensurable is what it was. It was awesome. Nice. The computer took with the sound that you put in and spit out all these video images. And because we had a two microphone setup, it responded both to the clarinet's things and to the horn things in different ways. And you could visually watch how that music was interacting with itself on the projector screen. And that was super cool. There's the original instrumentation was wackadoodle. It was like four saxophones, a cello, two violins, a piano, and electric guitar, maybe. It's called Big Decisions, and it's about the Whitlam dismissal in Australia. But there's a reduction for wind quintet, and I played that a couple years ago. It was amazing. It's all like speech rhythms. So all of the rhythms happening in the quintet are the rhythms happening in the interviews with Australian politicians happening on the TV. So this type of music where we were intersecting technology and aerophone is the type of things that really excite me.
Nice.
I would love to see, so one of my favorite composers is Caroline Shaw. And if you haven't listened to Caroline Shaw's music, you need to listen to some Caroline Shaw music. But I would love to see some kind of French horn chamber work from her. That would be my dream. If one day I could commission her to write something, I don't know if I would ever have a high higher than that. I would love, obviously I play a lot of mellophone. I played a mellophone concerto last year. I would love to see a new mellophone concerto by Michael Klesch. He's the brass arranger at Carolina Crown. It's a drum corps that I marched, a drum corps that I used to work at. And his mellophone writing's insane, and I would love to see what he could do in a concerto context. So maybe I'm not the best person to ask those questions.
Oh, that's fine. I guess I would just say, you know, there's a lot of ways to listen to French horn. For me, I was like, I just started picking out, you know, I'm a big film music fan. That was kind of my track of education. Master's degree was in film music. And I know on like some of your practice, like schedule, you know, you have a like little section where for like play along, and I feel like the first time I really got into French horn and really loved it, I was playing along with I think it was Robin Hood, Prince of Thieves. You know, this was the Michael Kamen score. There's a part where the horn goes yeah da 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 da, and I'm. I was like, oh, that's so cool, and I figured out, oh, it's mostly like open valve, you know, and so forth. And it was easy to get into. But like, if you're a Star Wars fan, I think it's neat how every, I guess, love theme, if you want to call it that, you know, it's like, I think in retrospect, you know, the first one was off a little bit because we find out, you know, that Leia is Luke's sister and all that. But, like, you know, all of them are presented by the French horn. They're all solo horn instruments. So it's kind of fun to listen for that. And I used to just like listen for the horn solo, like whether it was like, I don't know, Tchaikovsky's Fifth Symphony, you know, or something like that. It's just... but also brass quintets. I played in a brass quintet for a while. But the cool thing about the French horn is it also plays in woodwind quintets, because although it's technically not a woodwind instrument, it can blend with the other woodwinds and so forth. So so many places. I offered one. I just mentioned my favorite chamber piece, not nearly as adventurous, but it's the Poulenc piano sextet. And I never figured out, when I heard it, I couldn't figure out if I want to play the piano part or the horn part.
Sounds like you're going to have to do both.
Yes. Well, not at the same time, though.
Not at the same time. I really love what you just touched on, though, which is that we can find examples of French horn playing in tons of music. Yeah. And for you and me, we think of the big movie scores. We think of Jurassic Park, of Superman, Harry Potter, Star Wars. But I've recently learned that actually a lot of young people don't know those movies. So if you like any of the Marvel Universe movies, all of those have crazy awesome French horn parts in there, too. If you like Dune... The Dune soundtrack has some cool French horn stuff in it. You can find examples of French horn in Jacob Collier's music, in Beyoncé's music, in Taylor Swift's music. Yeah. There are ways that you can hear French horn all over the place that aren't just the normal, like, classical music that we hear. And if that excites you, those are things you can practice too.
Yes. Have to point out, 1982, the movie Conan the Barbarian, Basso Apollodorus' score. I don't know if it's true. I read this. He apparently hired 24 French hornists for the main title, and there's a lot. But it's like, I can't tell if, like, 12 French horns wouldn't sound the same. It's hard to tell. You know, I think live I'd notice, but recording is kind of hard to tell. So you mentioned mellophone. Let's talk about what are some peripheral instruments to the French horn family? So we'll start with the mellophone, but feel free to name a few others, you know, that you've played before that French horn has led you to.
Yeah, so we began by talking about single horns and double horns. And the single F, the single B flat, and the double French horn are all French horns.
Yes.
Which are not the same as all the instruments I'm about to list.
Right.
Which, although they are in the bucket and related to, they are not French horns. And if you play them, you're going to have to treat them as the not French horns that they are.
Right.
So you start with that mellophone. And a close friend, maybe foe of the mellophone, is the marching French horn, which is a little bit different. The mellophone's an F, the marching French horn is in B flat. Similar to our single horn adventures, but again, totally different instruments. We've got the Wagner tuba, which is an instrument that was invented by Richard Wagner to be played on his Ring Cycle, this crazy long several day opera that, if you don't know stuff about, you should look up on the internet. And this is like a crossbreed between a euphonium and a French horn. It takes a French horn mouthpiece and kind of plays in the same register as a French horn, but sounds a little beefier and a little more than a French horn. Mm-hmm. You have the alto horn and the tenor horn, which are different instruments. They both read an E flat most of the time, and you'll hear them in more of the British brass band tradition. So if you're thinking of like street bands, street marching bands in Europe, sit down bands in Europe, that tends to be where you hear the tenor horn. Oh, what else do we get? If you like jazz, there used to be an instrument called the mellophonium.
Wow.
Which is nothing similar at all to the mellophone, just kind of the same name. It kind of goes out, has a loop-de-loop, and then a really long front bell. And they used it as a super flugelhorn, so a lower-pitched flugelhorn, in the Stan Kenton big bands in, like, that 40s-era jazz. So you have the mellophonium. In that same kind of context, you hear the ballad horn, which is a weird little right-handed... It kind of looks like if you took a French horn and photoshopped it smaller. It plays with the right hand. You don't put your hand on the bell. You kind of hold it, and it's like this beautiful lyrical thing. And again, they used it in jazz, but they used it for the ballads and the beautiful solo moments. There's an endless tunnel on the internet that you can look up different kinds of French horns and French horn related things.
Nice. Consistent this podcast, I'm going to encourage everybody to try all of them, because I think you should experience as much music and not as little music as possible. So this is such a complicated instrument. I keep hearing little words and like, oh yeah, we need to talk about that too. So if you desire, or if you ever have the opportunity to play in a kind of traditional orchestra that programs kind of expected, especially like classical pieces, you're probably going to play music that was written before the French horn had valves, which means, you know, and this is kind of the thing, like F is kind of, I guess, what people decided on. This is where we'll put the valves on. But if you play symphony in E flat major, it's written for horn in E flat. If you play something in key of D, it's horn in D, and so forth. So like all of these Haydn, Mozart, Beethoven symphonies, and if it's not in F major, it's not written for the horn in F. So French hornists, if they have to encounter this repertoire and they don't have access to a transposed copy, they have to transpose as they go. They have to write it out, or if they have to do it in their head. I have a trick that I like, but I always like to ask other people, how do you do transposing when you have to do that?
I tend to transpose by interval. So what that means is my parts are usually horn and F, right?
Right.
If I have a part that says horn and D, I think about that difference. What's the difference between F and D? D is a major third below F, right? Or sorry, a minor third below F. So then I know that when I look at this music, I need to think about the notes that are a minor third away. Rather than, so if I saw, my brain's not going to let me give an example right now. I need to think of these notes a minor third away. If I have horn in E flat is a whole step below F. So I need to think about transposing a whole step away from the notes that I'm going to see on the page. How do you think of transposition?
So it's the same way, except one phrase, hand to stand. What the instrument, my hand is F. D is on the stand, so that's the direction. So like I go from F to D and not D, because sometimes I might, because I used to think before that, do I go up a minor third or down a minor third? And I go, so it's hand to stand, F down to D, I gotta go down a minor third. So
that's good. I've never heard that one before. That, because in my head I know which way to go, but thinking about what I just said 60 seconds ago, I don't think I ever articulated which direction.
Oh yeah,
That's a good mnemonic.
That's fun. That credit to Professor McNeilan, conductor at Jacksonville, for that. So I guess the only thing we haven't covered it's more of a general music thing, but I love anybody who thinks about practice to share about practice, and we could probably have a whole separate episode on it, but I want to talk about the thing that jumps out at me is that you think a lot about structuring practice and So I took a screenshot just so I could kind of like go over something recently that you posted. It was a low energy impact practice plan. And I think this was like, it was an hour and a half total. So like you spent 45 minutes on fundamentals. You have a 5 minute chop break. I assume that's like let the lips rest, you know?
Yep.
By the way, do you have, sorry, just to interrupt that in a moment. Do you have any tips for refreshing lips? I used to just like buzz the lips, but are there things that, that can like refresh the lips faster?
So by buzzing the lips, I assume you mean kind of doing that.
Yes.
Which is something I actually advise my students not to do. Okay. Because when you do that, what you do is you push all the blood away from your lips, which temporarily makes them feel better.
Right.
But all of that blood that was inflaming them, making them look stiff and swollen, it's just going to come back in a couple of seconds. It's really, there's you gain no benefit from doing that.
Right.
So, and I talk with my drum corps students actually a lot about this because we tax their chops so much over the course of the summer. Just like you would stretch at the end of the workout to break up the lactic acid in your muscles, you can do facial stretches. And like the one I just did is one I do with them, these kind of like opening mouth shape, kind of just like as if you were talking, for the people who aren't going to see the video, if you were talking with like crazy wide shapes in the way that, you know, stretches out your cheeks a little bit, stretches out your lips a little bit. You can do like a light facial massage with two fingers, again, with that goal of just breaking up some of the lactic acid that we've built up in these muscles from the workout and playing, right? That's a workout for these muscles that we just did.
By the way, it just makes me laugh. My composition teacher used to frequently say when he'd look at orchestrations that we would do, it's like, he'd say, you better put some rest in there or your brass player is going to have hamburger lips. So after your 5 minute chop break, you had 15 minutes of bass clef sight reading, 25 minutes of the Mueller etudes and 10 minutes of play along. So, and I think I've seen enough before that's just one example, but what are some general principles that you think about for practice structure? Like, do you try to always, I mean, that's actually, I guess one thing I would say is, you know, that's four different things. Do you always have to do four different things, or do you, what are some different ways that you like to practice just in structuring?
The structure of your practice is highly dependent on the goals that you have. So if your goal is to just not lose chops today, to touch the instrument, say hi to it, and be done, that practice session is going to look really different than if your goals are to prepare for the orchestra audition you have next week, or to get ready for your recital in 2 months, to get ready for your recital tomorrow, right? Like, the goals that you currently have, your short-term goals, always influence the structure of your practice session. And to speak in the broadest terms here, take those goals that you have, figure out what you need to do to achieve those goals. So if I have a recital in 2 months, I'm probably still learning my repertoire. If I have a recital tomorrow, I probably need to do a run through or take the day off. Look at those goals, figure out what you can do to help keep working towards them, and structure it out that way. Obviously, that's dependent on the time you have available to you. That's dependent on the other playing expenditures you have that day. Do you have a rehearsal you have to go to? Do you have a coaching you have to be at, or a lesson later? But take all of the input that you have and figure out what that looks like, and do it before your practice session starts. Because just like a workout, nobody goes to the gym and then figures out if it's going to be leg, back, or chest day. You go knowing what you're going to work on.
Right.
And then you do, maybe you switch up the exercises, right? Maybe you decide like, oh, today is not a lat pull down day. I'm going to do some whatever. But you don't go to the gym and walk around and go, oh man, I wonder what I'm going to work on today.
There's probably somebody out there who does.
Oh, I'm sure there is. And they're probably not getting that much stronger.
Exactly. Right. This is, again, an extensive topic. I think we covered like most of the things in my notes, but it is a complicated instrument. And, you know, I think one thing, I guess, you know, one thing we didn't really go over is, you know, should you start with a French horn? And I think the answer that I can gather from hearing how you've answered other things is it probably just depends, right? Because I started on French horn and you started on French horn, but there used to be this dogmatic from some people, you have to start on trumpet or then switch to French horn if you're ready.
So the district that I teach in ascribes to that philosophy. They only start students on flute, clarinet, saxophone, trumpet, or drums.
Right.
And because of that, there are not very many French horn players in this district.
Right.
So like my personal opinion there is I absolutely understand the philosophy why we would do that. I absolutely understand how that makes classroom teaching easier. But I also think that that de-influences students from learning some of these more challenging instruments that are hard to start out with, the bassoons, the oboes, the French horns, all of which are very underrepresented in the district that I teach in. So, you know, like, I think it's totally cool to start on French horn. You probably should tell that student it's going to be hard and they're going to have to practice and they're going to have to work for it. They're going to have to want it, but it's worth it in the end for the wonderful musical experience that we all get from it.
Well, again, it's so much we could talk about, but you have a lot that you say on a daily basis on the subject on Instagram for sure. Where can people follow you to find more about what you have to say about the French horn?
You can follow me just about anywhere at Kate Warren Music. That's K-A-T-E-W-A-R-R-E-N Music. That's my website, www.katewarrenmusic. That's my email. The platform that I'm most active on that you'll see the most information coming from me is Instagram. But I'm on just about anything. You can find me on YouTube, on TikTok. I think technically I have a Twitter. I don't know how to use it.
Yeah, well, the last episode I recorded with a guest, we recorded when Instagram and Facebook were down for a while. So we said Twitter was popular for that 1 hour. People who hadn't been on for a while got on, but yeah. Anyways, Kate, it was great to meet you not in person, but on Zoom. And and it was great to chat with you about this instrument that we both love. So thank you for that today.
Yes, thank you so much for having me, David. It was a pleasure.
And that's going to wrap up episode number 67. If you enjoyed this episode or you know somebody who might enjoy this episode, it would mean a whole lot if you would share it with at least one other person. It helps this podcast to grow, and it might just help someone you know with their musical journey. Just to reiterate, I highly recommend that you follow Kate on Instagram at Kate Warren Music, but also go to her website to see all of the things that she offers. And I would also recommend her YouTube channel, also at Kate Warren Music. One of the excerpts that we played in this episode was a small clip from one of her videos, which was that piece Incommensurable by Christopher Biggs that was performed by Kate and also Amer Hasan on the clarinet. If you'd like to leave feedback on this episode, any questions you have about the French horn or any thoughts that you have, you can, of course, send me a message at davidlanemusic.com or through a direct message at Instagram at David Lane Music or on Facebook at David M. Lane Music. But I would love it if you would be willing to leave it with your own words, with your own voice, by leaving a voice message at speakpipe.com/musician toolkit. That's speakpipe.com/musician toolkit. And once again, that's going to wrap up today's episode. Thank you so much for listening, and I'll be back with you again next week.